Hello, welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. If you have been a fan of Butch Karp and his author, Robert Tannenbaum, he has a new book, Fatal Conceit, published by Simon & Schuster Gallery Books. It is his best book of maybe, 25 books? Fabulous. Welcome, Bob.
Well, Connie, it's always great to be with you, and thank you. It's the 26th book, and hopefully it's each one is better than the next.
Well, this is because not only do we see Butch and his wife, Marlene, Lucy is over in Chechnya. We also bring other people into this world, being the president's campaign manager, and he's up for re-election, the lies that are told to the public, and what happens because of it. There is a love story, which beautiful, a general and a young woman, I suppose not unlike some other things we've seen in the military, and then a murder, a discovery, and a trial.
Well, that's right. The Fatal Conceit really deals with the whole notion of what people do who have unbridled ambition, weak character, and are involved in keeping power at all costs. And some of those costs are, as we know, the public is not told the truth. It's manipulated. There's a compliant, lazy press that doesn't probe. And they may resort to murder. And that's what this story is all about. General who's going to testify, who's formerly head of the CIA, acting head of the CIA, is going to tell the truth about a terrorist attack that happened in Chechnya, and the administration doesn't want that to happen.
You know, just turn on your TV today and see how ISIS took off a young second man's head. Not too different from what's happening in Chechnya here.
Absolutely. The real question that a lot of people are asking is how many heads will have to be cut off before this administration does anything to those people who are at war with us. And in Fatal Conceit, we're dealing here with the terrorist attack that takes place in Chechnya and Grozny, and the Russians claim every time the separatists who want to have their own country in Chechnya, there's been two major wars, anytime something happens, they'll blame it on the separatists and not on the terrorists. So the question is for us, the search for truth, which ultimately comes out in the trial portion of the book, is really something that these books are all about, because they're really value stories about not dumbing down everything that we see, but demanding that we raise the level of those who perform for us in the government, who serve, and that they enhance the dignity of the office. And that's something that I care about, and that's what these books are all about.
And in caring, they are there. And the fact that in that power, they didn't allow the drones that had guns and ammunition to save the people, the Americans who were over there. Well, that's not unlike that ambassador who was burned to death.
The ambassador, yes. Unfortunately, the whole Benghazi fiasco, not only did we leave people behind, we left them behind to be slaughtered and murdered. So there was no rescue attempt in Benghazi. And similarly, we have the same situation here with Fatal Conceit. So it's an override of power lust of those in government who will do virtually anything in order to maintain their power. And the victims, unfortunately, are the American people. And that's what really has to change. And that's why I did Fatal Conceit.
Yeah, and the two men who end up being on trial, Fohm, is that how you pronounce
Fohm.
It? Fohm. And Lindsay. Now, Fohm is that man you see who is a politico, and he is the president's right-hand help at any price.
He's the national campaign director for the president, and the head of the NSA is a co-defendant in the case. They claim that the general committed suicide, and our hero, Roger Butch Karp, who's the district attorney in New York County, probes the case. And once the grand jury, after presentation of the evidence, indicts for murder these two individuals, that is the national campaign director for the president's reelection and the head of the NSA, our local DA, our hero, Butch Karp, winds up being confronted with not only trying to amass the evidence against the killers, but at the same time, he's confronted with a lot of opposition and obstruction by the administration.
And he's told, wait a minute, this is national. FBI, you get out and you're going to hear from us in Washington. And Butch says, fine, let them come to me. But meanwhile, it's mine.
That's right. We'll see you in court is the notion that we deal with when we were in the Manhattan DA's office from outside jurisdictions. A murder that's committed in Manhattan, which is New York County, is the jurisdiction of the New York County District Attorney. And Butch Carpowitz served in the criminal courts in the Homicide Bureau, and now his district attorney is prepared to investigate this case and make a determination as to whether or not it was suicide, as the government says, or in fact was it murder, and ultimately was it committed by the main operatives within our government, and was there a major cover-up? And the courtroom scenes, of course, are probably the best work that I've done.
Absolutely. But before we get there, you've got the general who has been fixed up, well, the men who give the big parties. And they say to a friend, look, get all the pretty girls you can, not unlike a Hollywood party or any other party where money and men and their wives are back home.
Well, all too frequently we see this happening. I remember when I was chief assistant to Richard Sprague. I was deputy chief counsel to the committee, congressional committee investigation into the assassination of President Kennedy and Martin Luther King. I called our staff together because I told them these were, most of these fellows were people who really didn't have dates on Friday and Saturday night. And now all of a sudden, beautiful women were asking them out. And I asked them what really changed. And my admonition to them was simply, do whatever you think is right, as long as you don't mind seeing it on the front page of the Daily News.
My mother used to say in the front page of the New York Times, but depends upon what you read. Anyhow, the general has been invited by this man who is the foam, and his girlfriend, and he says, tell the girls who come, $1,000 for coming just to be there pretty, getting friendlier, gets you five.
The idea, of course, is in order to maintain power, part of what goes on in these circles is to try and compromise individuals. And one way to compromise them, which has been since we've had man and woman, is to try and have a married general, for example, in this particular case, out with a beautiful woman. And that'll somehow, in the minds of these people who have weak character, unbridled ambition, and who are involved in just maintaining power, to use against someone who is a person of conscience, who has ethics. And in our story, in Fatal Conceit, we have a general who's acting head of the CIA, as I indicated, who's going to tell the truth about the terrorist attack before a congressional committee. And it's the night before that attack that the action takes place with respect to the murder.
And it was interesting. They gave him Valium in scotch, and he sort of thought he tasted it. And then the murderer, Ray, comes in and shoots something under his tongue.
To make sure that that the murder takes place, that the killing occurs, the bad guys in our story don't want to just rely upon the poison that was given to him, and so they engage in some extracurricular activity to ensure that he, in fact, is murdered.
Now, where did you get the idea that he's calling his lover, and she is going into the bathroom and didn't realize she left her Skype on? So when she comes back and it's gone black, she said, well, I think I'll see, and discovers on her TV, on her computer, it had captured what was going on in his room.
Well, isn't it wonderful that here are these experts with technology, who are capable of conducting a war from Tampa, Florida, for example, and sending drones out, pinpointing individuals 10, 12,000 miles away, are caught on, hoisted on their own petard, if you will, with, in fact, the same technology that they use in order to destroy human life.
And, of course, there it is. Well, that begins the chase that ends up in a little cabin in New York. And at that point, the two evil guys, Lindsay and Folam, send murderers after them?
Well, the confrontation will take place because their plan is unraveling, and unraveling for them means that they're going to be indicted and tried for murder. And with our district attorney in New York County, no influence other than search for the truth is going to deter him, the district attorney, Roger Butch Carb, from bringing these people to justice in Manhattan.
Well, people who haven't read maybe the last five books don't know that he has a daughter named Lucy. And Lucy is a linguist, 19 different languages, including Navajo. She also is a very devout girl. Her mother, Marlene, was a devout Catholic at one point, and the father is Jewish. But for Lucy, she believes in the saints, and Saint Teresa is there for her to say, don't worry, I'm here to protect you till you die.
Well, it's a question of, the question is, why do we do this? And when we as individuals are confronted with certain tragic events, or we are the beneficiary of wonderful events, many of us believe that when you step back for a moment, there is some sort of an intervention, a divine intervention, with respect to how fortunate we may have been in our lives in making certain decisions at the last moment, for example, that worked out enormously successful for us. And that's really the effect that St. Teresa has with respect to Lucy, because it comes at times of major trauma, and this is a way psychologically for her to deal with it without crumbling and feeling as though she is helpless and a victim. She's contrary to that, and it disturbs to no end many of those who commit evil, because they don't see the fear in her eyes, which is exactly what they like to see before they commit these violent acts.
Have you been over there, Bob?
I have never been to Chechnya.
Yeah. Okay, because I felt you had walked the sand and done the deed.
That's the beauty of the virtual world in which we live.
Yeah. All right, we come now to the fact that he's able to convince and get an indictment, and we begin the trial. And there is a woman lawyer who is, well, I can think of a few I see on TV, but not as fiction, but as real.
Well, again, what you're dealing with here are those people who are in these high-powered law firms. They really don't have that kind of trial practice where you have, or used to have at least, in the DA's office. When I was in the Manhattan DA's office, I was in court with 100, 150 cases every day, 5 days a week, for a few years. And you learn how to deal in a courtroom setting. You're always respectful, but you're forceful with respect to representing your client. And the client for the DA, of course, is the people. You don't get that kind of training when you're in a white shoe firm, a Wall Street firm. They pick and choose those infrequent cases that actually go to trial. And Carp, our hero, the district attorney who's trying this case, has already tried a couple hundred cases to verdict successfully and is an expert. And he was trained by experts, as I was. I was very fortunate. I had two of the best people in the Manhattan DA's office, the two best trial lawyers in New York City who trained me, Mel Glass and John Keenan. And John Keenan right now was my bureau chief in the Homicide Bureau. He is now a federal district court judge in the Southern District of Manhattan, presently sitting.
And is he maybe a prototype for Judge Hart?
Very much so, I would say. He is. He's serving on the bench just as he did in the DA's office, with the kind of dignity and brilliance and fairness that he brought to the justice system as the head of the Homicide Bureau.
What do you want the reader also to take from this book, Bob?
I want everybody to understand that as I have served in the government and what our expectations are of people in the government, and that is, we just can't like the people in the government if they happen to agree with us on certain issues. What is the real question then? The real question, it seems to me, is the character issue. Who are these people who are representing us? And what really is the crux of what they should do, in my judgment, and that is to enhance the dignity of the office they serve. And that's why we need people of character to serve. Just as we had the founders, we had Washington, Adams, Jefferson, and Hamilton. These were people who promised, who gave their sacred honor, as they said, and committed their lives and their fortunes to serving the people. And that's how our republic was formed. And that is part of the obligations I believe we have, connecting with all other generations, is to continue to reform, improve, but at the same time to honor the traditions of this country and the value system that's made us great.
Well, that's terrific and speech. But what about the knowledge? Because today it seems to me not one man can know everything. And that's why they get advisors who maybe are below salt.
Well, you hit it on the head. It's not a question of knowing everything. It's a question of having people inform in the closest circles of our government and being able to make a kind of decision that requires character. And that character is our value system. And that value system is that we are a moral people. We try to institutionalize virtue. We know that evil exists, and we have to confront evil and defeat evil to protect our people. And if we have people who have that kind of character, more times than not, they'll make the right decisions for us.
Well, decisions, yes. What about education? I mean, fine, but if the person doesn't know technical, what's happening with various drones and new planes and submarines, you know, fine to have character, but it may not be applicable.
Well, the character is the issue of character is applicable to everything we do in our personal relationships and otherwise. But you can't expect one person to know exactly what's going on in the Silicon Valley, for example. But there are people who can explain that, and that all fits in to the notion of the equation of how decisions are made, and ultimately. Just as Harry Truman was confronted with very serious issues, Harry Truman was not the valedictorian of his class, per se, but he had character. He had the traditional values of America, and he made those decisions after listening to some experts, not the least of which was General George Marshall and Admiral Nimitz during the course of the war, of course, World War II. Mm-hmm. But he came to those decisions, and in his recognition of Israel, for example, that he came to these decisions because of his value system, his character. He enhanced the dignity of that office when he served. And that should be the goal of what we want in the people who serve.
What if we are facing other, in a sense, other worlds? Islamic, the Russian, they have a different value and what they call character.
No question that this has been a time honored factor in the life of our country. Jefferson, after all, was involved at the shores of Tripoli, as we know, dealing with the Barbary pirates. We try as best we can when we recognize who evil is and what evil is to try and somehow have a conversation with evil. It doesn't work, though. And we know that from our own history. And the recognition of others who can rationalize, for example, rationalize the bombing of the state of Israel with thousands of rockets and claim that Israel has absolutely no right to defend itself, well, we know that we're dealing with evil. And that's part of our value system. And that's part of being moral, is to recognize evil and defeat it. Otherwise, we'll have nothing left. And we'll be fighting in the streets and in our homes. And that's exactly what we don't want to do.
What do we do if the person who is of character does not think the same way you do?
Well, it's not a question of the way I think. I think, in fairness, it's the way I believe and I'm trying to express, and that's what Fatal Conceit is about. It's the way that the great heroes of America have thought, the great leaders that we've had, and again, they go back to the founders, and we work through. It was the notion of Lincoln, what he expressed at Gettysburg. The notion that the other people in the Confederate States had a very, very traditional background, and they sought secession. He objected to that, obviously, because he wanted to end slavery. So there are confrontations, there are differences. The question is whether or not we feel that we're secure in our value system. And there is a difference between Americans, I will say this, unhesitatingly, and Canadians and people of other countries. I'm a big believer in American exceptionalism. What does that mean? It's not a superiority notion, and it's not a notion that we're just better than someone else. It's not an arrogant position. It's a position, again, that we're moral, that we have this value system, this Judeo-Christian value system, and that we want to institutionalize virtue. We believe in tolerance. We believe in redemption. We want to live in peace, but we also recognize that evil exists, and evil must be confronted. And it was not confronted most recently in our lives in the 1930s, and we're sort of living through that nightmarish scenario that will leave the next president, unfortunately, regrettably, perhaps, with a very, very serious problem internationally that could result in a major war, unfortunately.
Please, God, no. Bob, I'm listening to you, and I do know you were mayor of Beverly Hills. That's not exactly mayor of New York City. But somebody has got to have come to you and said, have you thought about running for an office?
They have, and my answer is I want to keep doing exactly what I'm doing with respect to these books. This is my 26th novel, Fatal Conceit, and it's my 29th book. There are three nonfiction books, and my last nonfiction book was last year, as you know, Echoes of My Soul, about the most important case that ever came out of New York. It was cited by Chief Justice Earl Warren when he wrote the Miranda opinion. Another example, by the way, people will make mistakes. Who are in the government, just as they do in our own lives, just as we do, just as I do. We make mistakes, but we admit to them. We don't sweep it under the rug, and we try to correct it so that it doesn't happen again. And that's the kind of leadership we need. And there's still ample time for people to run for office, if you will. Yeah. But right now, I'm more interested in people reading my books than voting for me.
Okay, because in reading it, it's an unputdownable book. I mean, you keep going and going, and it is, I mean, the final line of the book is a showstopper.
Well, I appreciate, you know, coming to see you all the time. I don't know how you do it. You're probably the most read person in the world, and any compliment from you is very near and dear to my heart. Thank you
very
much.
Well, I mean it. You know that. Back to the book, Maxson and the group that he controls. Are there such groups out of the CIA or national help?
Well, there are. The CIA, let's put it this way, the executive intelligence agencies, and we include, of course, the CIA in that, there are a lot of others, hopefully are charged with gathering information and analyzing information that in some way potentially could be deleterious to the health and safety and defense of our country. And we need to have an effective CIA. We need to have executive intelligence agencies who are doing that job. And they present it to the chief executive, our president, through his staff and directly. So we have, though, rogue elements because we're dealing with human nature. And human nature has not changed. What has changed is the ability of humanity to enhance technology to mind-boggling levels and degrees that affect our daily lives, but human nature has not changed. So, for example, if you were to read Cicero today, you would know that his climb to power, to be the consul of Rome, for example, started when he decided he would be a prosecutor in Sicily and go after the governor there for corruption. But we understand Cicero better today than we did, for example, when we were in high school or college and saw him as a bust on a mantelpiece. The Ciceros of today, we know where they are. We know who they are. We know who they are in Washington, for example. We know who they are in local government. People who have this unbridled ambition and weak character usually end up with tragic events for people.
You know, it's funny, but life does catch up. And it's all here in this book with life and characters. And I thank you very much, Robert and Robert K. Tannenbaum, because Butch has come a long way. And even the twins. I love Giancarlo. And the other one is?
Isaac. Zach.
Zach, yeah. And they're all here, including Stupnagel. Why that name?
Well, it's sort of a play on words. I'll leave that up to the reader. She's Adrienne Stupnagel, who is a very independent, beautiful, exciting, glamorous, fearless investigative reporter, but an honest one, and who's a very close friend of Marlene Champy, who is the wife of Roger Butch Carp, and they were college roommates together at Smith. And she's always involved in some very, very exciting, dramatic, tempestuous relationships, and she has a prior relationship with our general, who's the acting head of the CIA, and I'll leave it at that.
But they had a great friendship, and something that goes on for 20 years can't be all bad. And even the fact you brought in the general's wife, who knew that life had changed, but she still loved him, and they loved her. Would you autograph my book, Bob? And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinson. Go to our channel on YouTube, Connie Martinson. You'll see two other shows with Robert that we've done in the past couple of years. So just some of the ways to keep up. Even this show will be on in about a week on YouTube. But support your local library. Best investment of time you can have. Take the child with you. It'll teach them how to read, and they will love books. And we'll see you next time. Thank you, Bob.
Well, thank you.